now. Everything is lovely, the world is so serene. When I say things are lovely, you know just what I mean. It means that I'll be happy, no more I'll have to guess. I feel so, oh, so happy since someone answered yes. Birds are singing merrily, the sun is shining peacefully, cause my baby don't mean maybe now. When the preacher questions me, I'll say yes sir, yes sir me, cause my baby don't mean maybe now. But I know mine is quite complete, because my baby don't mean maybe now. Birds are singing merrily, sun is shining peacefully, because my baby don't mean maybe now. When the preacher questions me, I'll say yes sir, yes sirree, because my baby don't mean maybe no. I just got this letter just yesterday. Now I feel a little better, and so I say, life is short, mine is sweet, but I know mine is quite complete, because
love are gleaming. Come to my arms, my dear one, my sweetheart, my own. Vow that you'll love me always and be mine alone. Leave night whispering trees above, fine night bringing you nearer, dearer and dearer. Deep night, deep in the arms of love.
Happy days are here again. The skies above are clear again. Let us sing a song of cheer again. Happy days are here again. All together, shout it now. There's no one who can doubt it now. So let's tell the world all about it now. Happy days are here again. Your cares and troubles are gone. There'll be no more from now on. Happy days are here again. The skies above are clear again. Let us sing a song of cheer again. Happy days are here again. So long, sad times. So long, bad times. We are rid of you at last. Howdy, gay times. Cloudy, gray times. You are now a thing of the past.
Happy days are here again. The skies above are clear again. Let us sing a song of cheer again. Happy days are here again. All together, shout it now. There's no one who can doubt it now. So let's tell the world about it now. Happy days are here again. Your cares and troubles are gone. There'll be no more from now on. Happy days are here again. The skies above are clear again. Let us sing a song of cheer again. Happy days are here again.
When they see you out with me, I don't blame them, goodness knows. Honeysuckle rose. when you're passing by. Flowers droop and sigh, and I know the reason why. You're much sweeter, goodness knows. Honeysuckle rose. Don't buy sugar.
You just have to touch my cup.
You're my sugar.
It's sweet when you stir it up.
When I'm taking sips from your tasty lips, seems the honey fairly drips. Your confection, goodness knows. Honeysuckle rose.
Free, and I'll do my best to relate it just as she told
me. Hey, the laws are outside. They're blocking the driveway.
Harriman died at the scene. His colleague, Joplin policeman Harry McGinnis, was so riddled with bullets, his arm was nearly detached. He would die before daybreak.
Gone are my blues and gone are my tears. I've got good news to shout in your ears. The long-lost dollar has come back to the fold. With silver you can turn your dreams to gold. Oh, we're in the money, we're in the money. We've got a lot of what it takes to get along. We're in the money, the sky is sunny. Oh man, depression, you are through, you done us wrong. Oh, we never see headline about red line today. And when we see the landlord, we can look that guy right in the eye. Oh, we're in the money. Come on, my honey. Let's lend it, spend it, send it rolling around.
Oh, boy, we're in the money. I'll say we're in the money. We got a lot of what it takes to get along. Let's go, we're in the money. Look up, the skies are sunny. Oh, man, depression, you are through, you've done us wrong. We never see a headline, about red line today. And when we see the landlord, we can look that guy right in the eye. We're in the money. Come on, money. Let's spend the rolling. Come on, money.
We're in the money. Oh, come on, honey. Let's let it, send it, send it, roll.
Together, the moon is hanging low. There's magic in its silvery light. It seems to say the time is right. Love me tonight. Life is so uncertain, and no one seems to know how long we have to linger on. Tomorrow we may both be gone. Love me tonight. Oh, let me feel your arms, and let me feel your kiss. Then if this great big world must end, oh, let it end like this. My lips are yours forever, my heart is in your hands. My love is yours to have to hold. Don't wait until the moon is old. Love me together. The moon is hanging low. There's magic in its silvery light. It seems to say the time is right. Love me tonight. Life is so uncertain, and no one seems to know how long we have to linger on. Tomorrow we may both be gone. Love me tonight. Oh, let me feel your arms, and let me feel your kiss. Then if this great big world must end, oh, let it end like this. My lips are yours forever, my heart is in your hands, my love is yours to have to hold. Don't wait until the moon is old. Love me tonight.
Good afternoon. This is the Barrow Gang. Now, if everybody will just take it easy, nobody will get hurt. Is that your money or the bank's?
Mine.
All right, you keep it then. Next time I'll aim a little lower. All right.
Take a good look, Pop. I'm Buck Barrow.
I leave tonight at heaven. the sweetheart waiting for me. My mammy, my pappy, I'm going to make them happy. I'm heading for heaven down south. Bye, bye, brothers, I'm going away. Bye, bye, sisters, I'm leaving today. Leaving for that southern climb where the sun shines all the time. I'm heading for heaven. I leave tonight at 7. I'm heading for heaven down south. Sweet music and laughter, why that's something to go after. I'm heading for heaven down.
Driving east at speeds exceeding 80 miles an hour, Clyde skidded into the Dexfield Amusement Park and campsite, located just north of Dexter, Iowa. The park offered the privacy needed to tend to the wounds suffered by Buck and Blanche. However, the discarded bandages, which were soaked with blood and the bullet holes in the car, began to attract the attention of the local residents. Finally, Dexter's two police officers began to add things up and didn't like what they found. They then called the Des Moines, Iowa Police Department for some additional help. Thinking that the strangers were probably nothing more than bootleggers or possibly hobos, an estimated 50 young men and women from the Dexter area decided to follow the police and watch the fun. After the Dexfield shootout, WD decided that life with Bonnie and Clyde had become far too dangerous. So he quit the gang and returned to Texas, where he was immediately captured. He then attempted to put as much distance between himself and Clyde as possible.
I have been indicted along with Clyde and Bonnie for the murder of Malcolm Davis, Fort Worth Deputy Sheriff. I was forced along under threat of death with Clyde Burr through many of his gun battles and saw him kill 5 men. Clyde Burr never seemed to care for killing anyone. All he thought of was himself. That's the reason I tried to escape. Just soon kill me as anyone. Thank you.
set up Bonnie and Clyde to be captured or killed, didn't matter, if Jordan could arrange a pardon for his son in Texas for two murders that Henry had committed.
2 days and two nights.
The police cars carried a massive armory of weapons. They prepared an ambush for the outlaws. This reconstruction of the ambush was made only a few days later.
For 3 days and nights, these officers lay in wait on this road, but Bonnie and Clyde were wary.
On the 23rd of May, the officers stopped Henry Methvin's father as he drove up the road. He was handcuffed to a tree and his truck left by the roadside as a decoy. On the third day, a tan-coloured Ford V8 turned into the road.
It looks like the car, fellas.
The police recognised Clyde as the driver.
That's him for sure, I'll guarantee you. Get ready now.
As Clyde saw Methvin's truck, he slowed down. The police prepared to open fire.
That's him, fellas. He reaches for it, let him have it. Look down!
The car stopped, riddled with bullets. This film, taken just a few minutes after the shooting, is not a reconstruction.
Here is Clyde Barrow and Bonnie Parker, who died as they lived, by the gun. Bonnie is seen leaning against Clyde. Clyde was a master gunman. Seldom did anyone ever live when Clyde got the first shot.
There were a pistol and a shotgun ready on the floor of their car. But the ambush had taken the couple by surprise. Within hours, sightseers were traveling to the ambush site. A procession of more than 50 cars escorted the shattered Ford to the police pound. Here, it was put on show. A fence was set up to stop souvenir hunters. They'd already tried to rip parts off the car and seize bits of Bonnie and Clyde's hair and clothing. On the back seat, lawmen found 3 light machine guns, a dozen pistols, and more than 1,000 rounds of ammunition. Bonnie and Clyde had had no chance to return fire at the ambush, but both of them had guns close to hand. 107 rounds had been pumped into the car in less than 2 minutes. Their bodies had been riddled with about 50 bullets each. The bodies of Bonnie and Clyde were displayed to prove that they really were dead. Bonnie was visited by 40,000 people, Clyde by some 30,000. Frank Hamer and the men who'd hunted down the couple became national heroes. There was chaos at the Arcadia funeral home when people rushed to see the famous corpses. Clyde's coat was exhibited. It had 40 bullet holes from the ambush. His gun was also shown. Close examination showed that it had 7 notches, one for each man he had murdered. Twenty relatives and friends stood trial for harboring the couple. The men were chained together, but the women weren't considered dangerous. W.D., already serving 15 years, got another 2. Henry Methvin had a life sentence. He also received an extra 2 years. Bonnie's sister Billy and Buck's wife Blanche were sentenced to 1 year and a day each. Bonnie and Clyde's mothers were put on trial. Their lawyer pleaded that love took precedence over the law, but the judge wasn't impressed by their defence or by Mrs. Barrow's ill health. Both were given 30 days in prison. Clyde was buried next to his brother Buck at West Dallas Cemetery. An aeroplane dropped a floral wreath. Although she had asked to be buried next to Clyde, Bonnie was taken to Dallas's Fish Trap Cemetery. The press was out in force. As well as her extended family, thousands of sightseers attended the funeral. Her sister and mother were inconsolable. Clyde's family was also there. Her family wrote an epitaph for Bonnie's grave. As the flowers are all made sweeter by the sunshine and the dew, so this old world is made brighter by the lives of folks like you. While on the run, Bonnie had sent poems to various newspapers. They included her own epitaph. They don't think they're too tough or desperate. They know that the law always wins. They've been shot at before, but they do not ignore that death is the wages of sin. Someday they'll go down together and they'll bury them side by side. To few it'll be grief, to the law a relief, but it's death for Bonnie and Clyde.
It is all over. The ends of law and justice have been served.
Good night, a thousand good nights. Here we have waited till moonbeams have faded and gone. Good night, a thousand good nights. I'll miss that love light I knew from the twilight till dawn. That one little moment met hours of bliss. forgetting what no man meant sign like this. Good night, tonight was like heaven. Hold me and kiss me and tell me a thousand good nights. Here we met at twilight, here we are at dawn. All those precious hours seem to fly. With the silver starlight, Mr. Moon has gone to rest. Parting brings us sorrow, till we meet again. We'll be lonely only for a day. So until tomorrow, let's smile while we say. Waited till moonbeams have faded and gone. Good night.
Sheriff Smoot Smith of Dallas County, Texas, who among all peace officers was
met him, who over 2 months ago were assigned Catch Clyde Barra and Bonnie Parker, two of the South's worst killers. This was terminated in their apprehension day before yesterday in the state of Louisiana.
Many other officers of several different states deserve a lot of credit that have worked and cooperated with the officers that participated in the apprehension of the two worst criminals the Southwest has ever known. In view of the fact that these criminals have been directly responsible for the killing of many of our fellow officers, we felt it our duty to do our best to stop their terrorism, which has extended over a period of some 26 or 27 months. Each and every officer present at the time of the capture deserves the same credit, as we all did our best. I regret that we couldn't have taken them alive, but that was impossible. I further regret that there was a woman that had to be killed, which couldn't have been helped.
There's not much to say now. It is all over. The ends of law and justice have been served. We fulfilled our duties of officers of law and carried out our orders of Sheriff Smoot Smith. I can truthfully say that we went through hell and came back.
Thousands attend the homecoming of Clyde Barrow. In this Dallas funeral home, his body lies as an ever-ending line of men, women, and children from every walk of life, filed by his casket for a fleeting glimpse of the boy who had wrought so much death and destruction. Everyone wanted to see how such a bad boy looked in death. In life, his very presence would have struck fear to their hearts, but now they fear him not. Clyde's body is borne to the grave. Again, tragedy and shame descend upon his aged father and mother. Like his brother Buck, he died at the hands of the law. Do you suppose a child was ever born that the parents did not immediately begin to dream of the purposeful life that child would lead, and of how proud they would be to watch that life unfold? In every mother's lap, there sits a future president, and no father ever dreamed that the little fellow holding his hand would ever become a gangster. And yet, it is the paradox of life that from the day your child comes into this world, a million conflicting influences begin to mold his character. The soul of that child becomes a battleground on which God and the devil fight for final victory. It is to be hoped that Clyde's younger brother, who is here shown attempting to console his mother, may yet vindicate the name of Barrow and make it stand for something in the community besides crime and murder. It is to be hoped that he will be able to withstand the temptation of easy money and the pleadings of the devil and bring some measure of sunshine and happiness to the lives of his aged parents in their declining years. At another funeral home in Dallas, 3 miles across the city from where Clyde's body lay, lies the body of Bonnie Parker, and here the crowd is even greater. As far as is recorded, Bonnie Parker was the worst woman bandit since the days of Belle Starr. She is the only woman ever to be shot down by officers of the law in attempted capture. Bonnie's burial was attended only by close friends and relatives, which numbered about 150 people, including her sister, Billy Mace, who is now a prisoner of the law, charged with the killing of two state highway patrolmen, of which her sister Bonnie had already been accused. Billy Mace is attended at the funeral by two deputy sheriffs and a matron of the jail. Clyde Barrow's mother and father, seen in the foreground, and his brother, also pay their respects to the girl who was Clyde's only friend and who died by his side. In the last few words of Bonnie's own poem, which she penned before her death, "To a few, it means grief. To the law, it's relief. But it's death to Bonnie and Clyde."
The couple, who had always been inseparable in life, were buried in family plots in different cemeteries.
My grandmother, she would not allow them to be buried side by side.